We are going to learn about some introduction about the Python, why it is so popular. There are so many languages coming and going. There are hundreds of languages coming and going, but very few languages are staying. Like C is one, Python is another one, and Java is another one, which are popular and they are staying. There are other like JavaScript and other things. But if you take high-level languages, C, Python, Java are so popular. Among these languages now, C is very old language, but still it is considered to be a very powerful language. Because C is the language which is used to develop so many other tools. Even Python is developed in C, Java is developed in C. But C area of application is slightly different. Now Python and Java, there is a competition, and Python is slowly overtaking, already overtaken Java. We can see it in the net. Starting from 2017, Python has overtaken Java, and slowly it is actually becoming the number one language. I think it has already become number one language. We'll see why it is number one. We are going to see it little later. I'll show you in the internet which are the popular languages right now. So I'm going to give some popular languages here. First, I'm going to give some popular languages. In the net, we'll see which are the popular languages. Then we'll see why Java is, Python is so popular. So I'll say popularity index. Think, okay, we'll see popularity index of programming languages. Programming languages. See here, if you take this popularity index, there is actually popularity index of programming languages. There is one website. So it is actually one of the popular websites. So here, if you see the website, these are all genuine website where which you can believe, say number one language is Python, and it is 30.6 of users. Among 100 users, 30.6 users are Python, then Java and so on. But slightly, I don't know why it is, actually the growth is always positive. Here the growth is slightly negative, but Python is going to be the number one language in another at least 5 years. That is sure, and maybe more than that, because of its features, which we are going to see. So right now, the Python is the number one language. There are other languages like Java, JavaScript, C, C++. Still, they are very popular languages. And we'll see the other websites, the popularity here. Here I'll see the top computer languages 2021. I'll also see one here. When you take this site, here Python is popular. 29.9% of the people are using Python. TIOBE 13.38, still C, still, I don't know. This is a different website. And when you take Python here, 11.87, more than Java, and the growth rate is plus 2.75. So any thing you check, any website or any project or any company you check, slowly they are migrating towards Python. Python is going to dominate the programming world. That is sure, there is no doubt about it. So we'll be learning Python. From my side, I'll put 100%, whatever I know. I struggle a lot to learn Python, in depth. So whatever features Python has, the powerful features, I'm trying to learn. I'm keep on learning from past 2-3 years. Whatever I know, more than that, I'll put efforts and I'll try to give you the concepts of Python. From my side, I'm assuring that I'll give my more than 100% to help you learn Python. But my efforts, I think, are not sufficient. You have to keep on put efforts to learn, to become expert in this language, because not just listening to classes may not make you expert in any programming language until unless you put a lot of efforts. So you have to put efforts, mainly you have to practice a lot. I'll be giving a lot of demos in my classes, wherever there is a feature, wherever there is a powerful feature of Python. I'll be giving some example, programming examples. I'll also be taking some complex programs given in placement drives to write some complex programs. But from your sides, whatever I have given based on that, by taking that as a foundation, you have to build on your own. So you have to put a lot of effort to expertise any programming language, not only Python. So from your side, you have to put a lot of efforts because Python is no doubt is a very easy language to start learning, but no language is easy to master unless you put efforts. So you have to ensure that you put efforts and you'll learn and practice from the concept, whatever I have taught. If you practice more, you'll benefit out of it. You can master quickly and you can start writing the applications. So this particular Python, what I'm going to give is not application oriented. I'll try to give you the powerful features of Python. Then you can have some application oriented Python with the help of libraries. So here I'll try to give maximum features which is making the power Python powerful. But surely I want to make you clear that it is not application oriented. So it is not possible to develop the projects from this, but I can surely assure you that you can write the programs very efficiently using Python. Application orientedness, you can get it when you master some library like data science. There are several libraries like NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib, Seaborn. If you master them, you can develop beautiful applications using Python. But this particular course is not for application orientedness. It is for mastering Python. If you are already in development field, if you learn Python, surely you can use it in application oriented, you can make it application oriented. From your side, you have to keep on put a lot of efforts. That is one thing that I want to make you clear. So that is actually some thing I want to give you in the beginning before I start teaching you Python. So Python is right now number one language, even though still Java is one more language which is used by many companies, but many companies are slowly migrating towards Python because of its so many powerful features. Now, when you take Java is also very good language. Now, if you take C, is very powerful. From past to so many years, it is developed in 1972. Still, it is there in usage, means you can understand how good the language is. But when you take C and Python, just I want to compare C and Python before I give the features of Python, which has made Python popular. Before that, when I take Python started development in 1991, I don't want to give you much history, but just I want to compare Python and Java. Both Java and Python, the language development started in 1991, and very quickly Java became popular because of internet, because of its internet abilities, it became popular very quickly. But Python from past some 5-6 years, it has become popular, and in 2017 it has overtaken Java as far as the usage is concerned. But Python is not a very recent language. It is its development started way back in 1991, in the same year when Java is also started. Java's development is also started in 1991. But Java became popular early. Still, it is popular language. But Python is slowly overtaking Java. Now, when I take C and Python, C is very powerful, and Python is also powerful. By default, it is not powerful, but you can make it powerful by using some powerful features. But C is readily it is powerful. But when I take C, it troubles you a lot by but Python will not trouble you a lot. So I want to just add humor to his, like Python is like a wife, which troubles you a lot. But C is like wife, but Python is like girlfriend, which will make you comfortable. So Python is very comfortable language to start learning and to use it. But C is surely a very good language, but you have to face a lot of troubles when you use C. That kind of, if you are already a C programmer, you might have already faced the troubles that are given by C, but Python will make you always comfortable. So Python is the language which will make the programmer comfortable because of its features. So we are going to see the features of Python, which has made Python language powerful. We have just I have given you the popularity of Python. We have seen in the website Python is the number one language, and also briefly I have compared Java and Python as far as the development is concerned and popularity is concerned, and C and also Python have compared. We will be keep on comparing a lot of things because some programs I'll write in C style, but which you should not do it normally. So I've compared the C and Python as far as the comfortability is concerned. Python is very comfortable, but C is it troubles the programmers a lot. But overall, when you take, because C is very fast language, still C is popular. Now, when you take C and Python here, Python, why it is popular, we are going to see. Python is high-level language, C is high-level language, Java is high-level language. I'm not going to give you what is high-level language, what is middle-level language, and what is low-level language, because it is generally learned along with C. So just remember that like C and Java, Python is high-level language. when I take Python, it is object-oriented language. So I'll start writing here. So the features of Python, which has made popular. So Python is object-oriented. That is one thing. What is object-oriented? If you don't know, no worries, because we are going to learn much about object-oriented concept after we learn some features of Python. So Python is object-oriented. What is object-oriented? I'm not going to give you much. Like Java is object-oriented, but Java is pure object-oriented. Python is object-oriented and also procedure-oriented. So these two concepts you will be learning along with the language. I'm not going to spend separate time to teach you what is procedure-oriented and what is object-oriented. There is separate topic object-oriented. Then we'll compare what is object-oriented and what is procedure-oriented. Just remember that Python is both object-oriented and procedure-oriented, but Java is purely object-oriented, and C is purely procedure-oriented, but Python is both. So C is only procedure-oriented, Java is object-oriented, Python is both. So you can write procedure-oriented language programs and also object-oriented programs using Python. If you are already know Java and C, you might be knowing what is object-oriented, what is procedure-oriented. Python is object-oriented language, that you keep in mind. Then Python is dynamic. What is this dynamic? We'll be learning in the initial phase itself, what is this dynamic thing of Python. Java is partially dynamic, C is fully static. Generally, there is two terms with respect to this. One is dynamic, another is static. So this, I'll give you, after we see the features, I'll give you why Python is dynamic, what is dynamic, what is static. Just remember at this stage that Python is a very dynamic language in several aspects. Java is some aspects it is dynamic, but some aspects it is static. What is that? I'll give you in the beginning classes itself. But C is fully static. Java is partially, with respect to some aspects it is static, with respect to some aspects it is dynamic. So that is one more thing I want to give you. Python, as I told you, one more feature, Python is high-level language. Means it is English-like language, writing the programming is easy. That's what high-level, that is the definition I can give you at this stage. These are the general features. Now, when I take the other feature, Python is very simple. Python is very simple. So very simple means even if you take here, there are several aspects with this simplicity. You can, it is easy to learn. Easy to learn, that is one thing with respect to Python. And second thing is, it is, the program writing is simple. Program writing is simple. So that means you can build the logic in an easy way, program writing. Here, program writing means logic. So whatever way you solve the program is logic. So logic is simple here. This is two aspects. And when I take this, this is so, it is easy to start learning. But as I told you, it is not, any language is not easy to master. So you will feel comfortable when you start learning Python, even if you are new to programming, and even if you know some language already, like C language, if you know, you feel Python is more comfortable. But when you are already a programmer, you are C programmer or Java programmer, if you want to master Python, you have to forget something or undo something. Because when you are a C programmer, we have habit of developing a logic from scratch. But if you do the same thing in Python, you are doing wrong. So that we'll be taking some examples in the beginning itself. How the logic is generally built in C, how logic is built in C, how it should not be built in Python, and how it should be built in Python. So it is, you will feel very comfortable to start learning, but as I already told you, it is not easy to master any language, not only Python. So you have to put a lot of effort. So simplicity to start learning, to migrate, suppose if you are already a programmer, to migrate from C, Java to Python, it will be very comfortable. That's why it is simple. And when I take one more feature here, which is a contradictory feature, contradictory to simplicity, so powerful. So when I take the Python language, it is powerful language, means very complex logic you can build with a simple code. Very complex logic you can build with simple code. How it is possible, I'll give you. So it is very powerful, at the same time it is very simple. So very few languages, if you take C, it is not simple to write programs, but C, surely the C programs are powerful but not simple. Even Java case, it is very powerful but not simple. But two contradictory things, simplicity and powerful, they will be very rarely paid. But in Python, Python is a very simple language, and at the same time, it is very powerful. You can build a complex logic with a very complex logic with a very simple code. So that is one thing that you should know about Python. Python is very powerful language. Because it is, it can be built very, you can build a very complex code with simple logic, simple code, a complex logic with simple code. The one more feature which is linked with this too is productivity. You know what is productivity? Productivity is nothing but the amount of code you generate, because it is very, you can develop some complex logic with a very simple code. So the amount of code what you had to write will be very less. So overall, if you take development of the software, you can do it very quickly. So productivity is very high, high productivity with respect to Python, because it is very, you can write very powerful, complex logic with simple code. So productivity is naturally good. So productivity means the solution, whatever you give for over a period of time, you can say productivity. So productivity is very high compared to C and Java. Surely it is very high, because the amount of code you write to solve a same problem in C, in Python is very less compared to C and Java. So naturally the productivity is high. So the solutions, the number of solutions you give is productivity. So surely you'll be giving more solutions or a same solution in less time if you use Python compared to the time what you take to develop the same solution using C and Python. So productivity is very high compared to C and Java because the time you require to solve a problem is very less. So there is one more feature of Python. The next feature of Python, it's a very elegant. So the code look very stylish. Code look very stylish. So that is the one more feature of Python. Normally, if you elegant code or stylish code here will be linked with one particular feature called readability. So one particular feature called readability. That means when code looks very nice and stylish, here readability means here, suppose if somebody has written the code and if you go through the code and if you are able to understand the code easily, then the readability of the program is good. Because the code is very stylish and nice, it is very easily understandable. So readability of Python program is very good, high. Readability is high. Means if I go through C program, it is very difficult to understand the code because the code is normally complex. But as I told you, the code here is, the code is simple. So it is easily understandable. It is not only simple, it is elegant. Means the code looks stylish, so you can easily follow it. So because you can easily follow it, its readability is very high. So these are some features which has, see, there are so many good features related with Python, like simplicity, powerful, high productivity, elegant. So this particular features, when I take the features, they are not powerful. Of course, powerful is there. Now, if I take this particular feature and this particular feature and this particular feature, they are not there in Java. And this is also not there in Java, but Java is object oriented, but not processor oriented. Java is high level language. Java is powerful, no doubt about it. But elegancy, the code elegancy, if you take Python is more elegant. So Java is more, Python is more readable. And so the productivity is very high. So these are the features of Python, which has made the Python popular. If anybody has any doubt in these features, they can ask before we proceed with the other things. Anybody has doubts, please you can ask the doubts, because I'm going to have, these are the features we have covered. If somebody has doubt, you can please ask the doubts. Anybody, please, if you have doubts, you can ask, otherwise I'll proceed. Any thing, if you want more elaborate, say you can always, sometimes I may be fast, so please let me know if I'm going fast, so that if you give me the feedback, I can adjust to your pace. So that's what I wanted to know. So otherwise I'll proceed with it. So these are the features which has made Java very popular. Now, when I take these features, and because of these features, not only this, there is one more powerful feature which has made Python very powerful. Is so when I take this this feature, I want to keep it separately. I have not added. So when I take the power of Python. So I have given so many features which are making. Instead of power, I can say, I'll say strength of Python, the main strength of Python. I've given so many features, but they are not come under the main strength of Python. The main strength of Python is other thing. So the main strength of Python is the library. So when I take, we'll be learning much about library. So it has got very huge and very powerful and very dynamically growing. So if you take the library of Python, it is keep on growing on day-to-day basis, not day-to-day basis, hourly basis, it is growing. So when library is growing, the programming becomes simple. So it is directly proportional. The time of development of software using some language is directly proportional to the size of the library. If library is good, very huge and very powerful, then the time required to develop the software is less. So you can observe the code, even simple codes, whatever we write, we can take some programs, we can write the same program using C style of coding. But if you adapt to Python style of coding, you can easily understand how powerful C is and how powerful the features of Python and how powerful the library is. You are going to see it in a lot of demos we are going to see. So the main strength of the Python is library. I'll be giving you much about library in this same class. I'm giving I'll be throwing light on library. But just remember at this stage that the main strength of Python is library, because library makes the development very quick and very easy. So if you don't know what is library, don't worry. I'm going to give you much about the library. Just remember that Python has got very powerful library. Java is Java also has got very powerful library, but not as dynamic as Python, because Python library is growing. It is especially the third party library. So what is the third party library? What are the different parts of libraries that are there in Python? I'm going to give you. So when I take the third party library, the Python's third party library is the best among the languages. So that's why Java is popular. So this is the main strength of the Python. And there are other strengths, like elegancy is one strength, productivity is one strength, simplicity is another strength. So I've given already different strengths, but when somebody asks you what is the first strength you want to name with respect to Python, you can say library, because the other features okay, but main strength of Python is the library. So we are going to discuss much about the library and any language, languages like Python, Java, mainly we'll be learning them in terms of the library. So this is the main strength and main weakness also I'll give you before we proceed. So main weakness of Python. So anybody guess, any guess what is the main weakness of Python? So otherwise I'll give you the main weakness of Python is its speed. So it is very slow. Why it is slow is it is interpreted. So what is interpreter? I'm not going to give you because normally those concepts will be learning along with C, interpreter, compiler. So if you take Java has both interpreter and compiler, final stages, there will be interpreter and there will be some intermediate code generated using compiler, but Python is interpreter, C is compiler. So when you take C, C is very fast. So C is very old language. When you take any code which is written in C is executed faster than any code written in other languages. So the main weakness of Python is its speed, because it is an interpreter. So because it is an interpreter, it is actually slow. Why an interpreter is slow, I'm not going to give you here. You can refer somewhere. Or you can refer my videos that are there in YouTube to know what is interpreter and what is compiler. But just at this stage, here in Python course, I'm not going to give you what is interpreter, why interpreter is slow, what is compiler, why compiler is fast. But just remember that Python is interpreter, it is slow. But this particular thing, I'll give you the demos. So if I take any code, C style of code written in Python, it will run faster. But this you can overcome. Just remember that this is a weakness which you can overcome. So you can overcome with the Python features. So main aim of this course is how to overcome this speed problem. So wherever possible, I'll be giving you the tips how to overcome the speed problem, because if you can use the powerful features of Python, surely you can overcome this speed problem of Python. So overcome with the powerful features of Python. So whenever I discuss a particular feature, I'll give you how the that particular feature is making the program faster. So with powerful features. So normally when you write a code in C and when you write a code in Python, surely Python code runs slower. But you can make it up with the help of powerful features and library. So again, library is coming into picture. So library is crucial for Python. Library is crucial for Java language, but library, C has got very poor library. So that's why anything we develop in C from scratch. So that is the main difference between C and Python. See, the development time, here are two things. When I take, there are two times here, time to develop the software. There may be a confusion here. So that's why I want to elaborate it. This is one time. Second time is time to execute. These two are different. Time to execute the program. This is best. Python is best in this case. And this is Python is not good. But not good if your code is not good. So you can make this up. So time to execute, not good, but you can surely overcome this problem with the help of this. If you can use the Python powerful feature at appropriate place, so some feature should be used at for some logic. If you're using that particular feature for that logic, surely speed will increase. The library always help you increase the speed. Why library increases the speed, I'll tell you, and we can also see in demos. So when I take time to develop the software, the best language is Python. Time to execute, it is not good, but it does not indicate that it is end, but you can make it up. You can make this speed of execution as good as C's speed of execution. If you can use the powerful features and library of Python. So I have given the Python, the problem with the Python, it is speed, and I've given the strength, the main strength of Python, which is its library. I'm not, if you don't know the library, don't worry much. We are going to learn, because any recent language like Java and Python, main concentration will be library, but Python's library is different. I'll be giving you much about the library. So these are the features which are making Python popular. At the same time, there is one biggest drawback of Python. There is a biggest drawback of Python, which is speed, and that you can, if you are a good programmer, if you are an ordinary programmer, surely it will trouble. The speed is the biggest trouble. If you are a good Python programmer, surely you can overcome this problem. So the main, as part of this course, I'll be giving you what feature make the program faster. So where to use what feature, like there are so many things that are there. Suppose there are some data structures like list, tuple, sets. If you use list at in one particular situation, it make the program faster. If you use a set in other situation, it will make the program faster. So as part of this course, we'll be learning what to use where and when. So what feature of Python to use where and when, so that the program becomes efficient. So we'll be learning much about this. So overall, because the speed problem we can overcome, as I told you. So overall, right now, the programmer's choice is Python. company's choice is Python, because most of the top companies, like if you take the top companies like Google, Microsoft, all product-based companies, any good company, Google, Microsoft, Amazon, they're widely using Python. These are all product-based companies. So even if you take all service-based companies, Indian MNCs, they are widely using Python. So huge demand is there for Python. So if you can learn Python and master it, you have very good opportunity. If you are already a programmer, then it is some habits you have to undo, because especially C programmers, I'll be helping you. Generally, I'm also fond of C. So when I solve a problem, when a problem is given, my intuition says go in C way, so I'll be writing C code. But if I do that, I'm doing some mistake, and I'll not be getting benefit out of the Python. So one thing what I want to say here is, when you are becoming a Python programmer, and some program is given, some problem is given to you, you want to develop the software, think in terms of Python. Don't think in terms of C. If you think in terms of C, if you're a C programmer, surely you'll be thinking in terms of C. If you think in terms of C, you are not utilizing the features of Python, then it will impact negatively. The biggest problem is the speed of, even the speed of time to develop will also suffer. Time to develop software will also suffer if you're using C style of coding. So I'll be giving you, I'll be taking one problem first, initially, at least in the beginning stages, I'll be taking a problem and giving you the C style of coding. Then I'll be giving you the Python style of coding. So you can see the difference. So you have to, when you are, if you are very new to the programming, surely it is always better, because you are you don't have any influence of any other language. So if you have influence of especially C, surely initially you'll be struggling to write the logic, because I've seen so many students who are very good at C, but when they are given with a problem, they think that solution in terms of C, and they'll not be writing efficient Python code. So if you are new to programming, there is no problem at all. If you are already a programmer, especially C programmer, then you have to change your habit, or you have to change your thinking, because you have to think in terms of Python style of coding you have to write. Then only you can write a good Python program. So this you keep always in mind. So whenever you are given with a problem, think in Python style. There only you can write the program efficiently. This you can always keep in mind. So if you take this, many companies, they are actually started using Python. So if you master the Python, it will surely help you to grow in your career. There is no doubt about it. I am repeating this. I'll be putting my more than 100% efforts. From your side also, you have to put more than 100% efforts to become a good Python programmer. So I'm not promising you that I'll be making you very powerful Python programmer, but I'm promising you that I'll give you the best Python logic. You can compare it with anywhere. So I'll give you the best Python logic from your side. If you put equal effort, surely you can become a good programmer. A very good Python programmer. So it is not just my efforts, your efforts are also very important to become a very good programmer. So this is just the strength and weaknesses of Python. We have not entered into the language. So we'll be entering into the language little later. Next, the next thing what I have to do is, normally, when we start learning the language, we have to know the IDEs. So IDEs are very important. So in the beginning classes, it is always better to know about the IDEs, integrated development environments. integrated development environments we'll be seeing here. So I'll be giving the ideas which are used in Python before we proceed to any other thing. So environment. So normally when I take any language like C, Java, Python, we will be doing so many activities like compilation or interpretation in case of Python, debugging, editing, then execution, then we'll be doing some linking. There are so many activities we will be doing as part of development of software. You may also have to write some documentation. So if any environment, any tool which provides all these software development facilities at one place, it is called as IDE. So IDE is a tool which allows you to use a language with all features, with all necessary features like editing, development of code, saving the files, retrieving the files, compilation, execution, debugging, all those features at one place is actually IDE. Python has got so many IDEs. We'll be using some IDEs. Here I'll be listing the IDEs which we are going to use, which are popular and which we are going to use. Now, when I take these IDEs, first I'll list the IDEs, whatever available. Then I'll tell you which IDEs we are going to use. There are some IDEs like Eclipse IDE for Python, which is called as PyDev. Now, when I take this Eclipse, it is not only used for Python, it is also very popular for Java. So PyDev is Python IDE with respect to Eclipse. There is Sublime Text. This is also general IDE, not IDE specific to Python. So first I'm giving the general IDEs, Sublime Text, then Autumn, then Visual Studio. These are the IDEs which are general, means they are not specific to Python. These are general IDEs. If you take Eclipse, it is also there for Java. I don't know whether with other languages it is there. I think it is there with other languages also. So these are general IDEs. You can use any of this. Like Eclipse is very popular. It is also popular for Java, Sublime Text, Autumn, Visual Studio. They are general IDEs. Now, there are some IDEs specific to Python. The IDEs which are specific to Python, like PyCharm is one of the IDE. So PyCharm is one of the IDE. Then there is Spider. Spider is very popular. It is popular among in the develop industry. Spider is popular. Thorny is another IDE. Then IDLE is default. So if you install Python, this will be available. So we are going to use this IDLE, Integrated Development Learning and Learning Environment. It is the default. And if you install Python, this will be available. This is, I think it is, this is industry standard. The others are also very popular. We are also using one industry standard IDE, but not one among this. IDLE is not industry standard, but at least for learning, it is very good and we'll be using IDLE for some programs. Now, when I take the browser-based IDE, the remaining IDEs are standalone normal application. But if you use Jupyter Notebook. It is browser-based IDE. And this is actually, we are going to use Jupyter Notebook, not as it is See, there is actually over Jupyter Notebook as a superset of Jupyter Notebook. There is one very popular IDE, Google Colab. It is actually based on Jupyter Notebook. You can say it is superset of Jupyter Notebook. So what is that advantage I'm going to give you, the Jupyter Notebook advantage. But we are not using Jupyter Notebook directly, but we are using another tool called Google Colab. This is browser-based IDE, Jupyter Notebook, but Google Colab is cloud-based. So we will be using this server. I'm going to give a brief demo about the Google Colab if possible today itself. So we are going to use Google Colab. It is very powerful. What is that advantage of Google Colab? Because when we start writing the code, we are going to use Google Colab. So we'll be using IDLE. So we'll be using IDLE and Google Colab. And Google Colab is built on Jupyter Notebook. It is very powerful. You can also keep it in your resume that you are familiar with Google Colab, not with IDLE. Because Google Colab is very powerful and it will make the things much simpler. So this is about the IDEs. I'll give much about Jupyter Notebook and I want to give about Jupyter Notebook. One thing here is normally when I take Python, we'll be creating .py files. Like suppose if I write a C code, I'll be using. So if I write a C code, I'll be using .c files. If I write C code, I'll be using .c for C, .cpp for C++, .java for Java, .py for Python. So normally if I use IDLE or most of the environments will get .py files. But if I take Jupyter Notebook, we'll get IPNPYNB files. It is interactive Python notebook. It is because Jupyter Notebook is interactive Python notebook. Here, the main advantage is you can do documentation along with code, documentation plus code. So this is biggest advantage of Jupyter Notebook. You can, when you take software development, documentation means you have to write something about the logic, the question, the solution, the procedure, what you are following. Suppose if you want to make a note of it, you can mix it with program. So that is one greatest advantage of Jupyter Notebook. So you can combine code and documentation. That is the biggest advantage. So we are going to use this Jupyter Notebook in Google Colab, which is cloud-based. So you can mix the documentation and code, and the environment is interactive. You can directly run shell scripts, Python scripts directly, simple commands. You can directly run at the prompt, whatever you get. So that is one biggest advantage of this Jupyter Notebook. You can mix the documentation code means, suppose if you want some explanation, some procedure about the software you are developing, suppose if you are developing a data science related software, you want to give some documentation, write some procedure, so you can mix it with code. So that is, so everything will be available in IPONB file, but in case of Python, only Python code will be available. When I say .py, it is purely Python code. Now .pynb file, it will mix the documentation and code that is also there in Google Cloud. So when I take the Google Cloud, in addition to this facilities, because Google Cloud is built over, if you are not, points, whatever I'm giving, if you are not comfortable, don't worry, because I'm going to give demo for this, all these things, especially Google Colab. So if you don't know what is documentation, how we can mix, we are going to do it. Just remember that. IPMB file is slightly different from PY file. PY file is both Python code. IPYNB file is documentation plus code. It is generally a Jupyter notebook, we can mix documentation, and even Google Colab allows this, and Google Colab is built over Jupyter notebook. So whatever there in Jupyter notebook is available in Google Colab, and it is much more in Google Colab. So Google Colab is cloud based. So I'm going to give you the Google Colab here. So if you say Colab, because I have already created, if you have Google account, you can just open it. The advantages I'm going to give you. So this environment we are using very widely. So that's why I want to give you this particular thing in the beginning itself. So here you can start a new notebook because it is built on Google Jupyter notebook. Everything is IPvNB file, not pure Python code. So here you can see this is IPvNB file. The first advantage is whatever code you write here. So this is actually, I'll take Python 7 to 8:30 batch. So 7 to 8:30, I'll name it as 7 to 8:30 here. So this is one thing here is whatever you have, it will be stored in Google Drive. So you need not worry much about these files. You can access it from anywhere. This is first advantage. So if you use Google Colab, it is cloud-based environment. So you need not have anything in your system. You need not have Python. So that is first thing. So if you use Google Colab, you need not have Python in your system because it is cloud-based. Everything is provided by Google collaborative environment. That is one thing. So you need not have Python. It will provide you. And second thing is you need not bother about managing the files. Files will be automatically saved. You should have only Google account. The files will be automatically stored in Google Drive. So you can access that Google Drive from anywhere, and you can also share. This is one more greatest advantage. So there are two advantages I have given. One is you need not have Python. Second is they will be stored in Google Drive. So you need not bother about managing. You need not search for it because it is there in Google Drive, and you can easily share with other people. If you feel you want to share, you can share it with other people. These are two advantages. Now, the best advantage is it will also provide you the powerful, it will also provide you the powerful process. So you may have very simple system. You may have very simple system. Like suppose if you want to execute complex programs, your system may not be having good processor, good configuration, but it will help you because it will, your system will just submit the code. If processing is done in the Google Cloud server. So it will give you the powerful processors, that two dual processors. I'll show you the processor here. I'm giving a command with this, what processor you'll get it. So this is execution here. You will be seeing the other things. Don't bother much about it. So there will be one powerful processor at your disposal with a huge cache, 39, nearly 40 MB of cache is available. Not single processor, there are dual processor. So two processors at your disposal, processor zero and processor zero. They are processor zero and processor one. Xeon processor, very powerful processor. So two processors are at your disposal. So your programs will be submitted by your system to these processors. These processors will execute it within no time. So this is one more thing, advantage of Google Colab environment. So processors, huge, powerful processors, 64-bit processors with very high memory, and processor is Xeon. Xeon is a very powerful processor in Intel. Will be using something like i5. Xeon processor is more powerful than this processor. And one more thing here, you can observe here, there is also you can observe nearly 13 GB of RAM is given. 13 GB of RAM for your execution is given by the by Google Colab environment, and also more than 100 GB of hard disk. You can also temporarily store the files. So these are the resources they are giving. Two powerful processors, 13 GB of RAM and 100 GB of hard disk will be given to you. So this is one greatest advantage of Google Colab environment. So most of the people are using Google Colab. So you can also use it. If you have other environments, it does not matter. You can use it, other IDEs, if you are already familiar, and if you have with you, you can use it. So I'll be giving my demos, all demos on Google Colab environment, which is very convenient. The only thing is you should have some internet facility. Then processing will be provided by Google. So these are the advantages of Google Colab. So you can mix, you can get the benefit of Jupyter Notebook. You can get resources like powerful two processors, memory, and hard disk. So this is Google Colab environment. So we are going to use Google Colab environment for all our programs. So that's about the Google Colab environment. I'll be giving you demos on this. And when I take IDLE, this when you install Python, you can just search for Python. You can install Python here. When you install Python, IDLE will be there. And I've installed a recent version of Python, which is 3.9. So 3.9 is the latest version of Python. So I'm using in IDLE Python 3.9. That is, so I'll be using for some programs like files, I find use local files, I'll be using IDLE, but most of the times I'll be using Google Colab because file, because it is a cloud-based environment, files, each time, suppose if I want to deal with files, each time I log into the Google Colab, I have to upload files. So to overcome, to avoid those kind of problems, only files related, which is very small topic, files related things I'll be using IDLE. Otherwise, I'll be using Google Colab environment, which is very useful. You can also keep it in your resume that you are good at Google Colab. So I'll be using this IDE. So this is very simple IDE. As I told you, you can directly type the codes here. This is the command prompt you get. So Python's flexibility is I need not write a code or program. I can directly execute something like this because it is it gives command prompt where you can type some commands directly. So I can say I equals to 10. I can say print A plus A into 100. So these things I can do it directly on command prompt. That is one more advantage. But we'll not be using much this command prompt. We'll be directly using the codes, especially Google Colab environment. Same thing, you can also do it in Google Colab environment. Suppose if you want to know version, it is already giving here. It is saying it is using 3.95 version. But if I take Google Colab, I don't think it is. It uses the latest version because it uses always a standard version. Until unless that version is actually tested and used by several users, it will not shift. So I'll be giving you the version here. Don't worry much about the code, what I'm writing. I'll say print sys.version. It will give you the version, Python version it is using. So it is using 3.7.10. It is not the latest version. It is actually it is installed on May 3rd. So it is also not very latest version, but it is, but Google Cloud, it will take only if everything is okay. Suppose if there are some problems with that version, it will not suddenly migrate. So unless a version is thoroughly tested and certified, then only it is going it will shift. So Google Colab is using 3.7.10, but IDLE uses because I have installed very recently. So to get the latest version, I have installed very recently. I'm using 3.9.5 version. So I'll be giving mostly demos on Google Colab, and some demos I'll be giving even in this IDLE. So that is the brief picture about the IDE is what I'm going to use, because IDE is also very important thing here, because when you develop the software, IDEs are very, very much required. So I'll be using this IDE.